All of a sudden, one's email inbox starts filling up with conspiratorial invitations and timid overtures. People you never heard of confide in you their guilty ornamental pleasures, their clandestine flirtations with decoration. Desperate for a sympathetic ear, they confess the derision they suffer at the hands of their peers and their longing for an ornamental comrade. Eager to please, one stretches out a hand, only to find that these strangers, more often than not, do not speak of ornament at all, but of other things, such as patterns and classicist quotations. Another, much more rarefied thing happens too, namely that people familiar to you unexpectedly reveal an interest in the topic. A side to their character that you never knew existed. You are surprised, and very pleasantly so, like when at 40 you first realized that your mother is quite adept at juggling oranges. And this is exactly how I felt when Peter Kahl got in touch with me regarding a publication of mine on ornament. Knowing Peter as a generous critic and brilliant writer, it was the perfect opportunity to bring him to the AA for a long overdue lecture and an insight into some of his less well-known interests. Peter Kahl trained at Princeton, where he gained his bachelor and then his master in architecture in 1973. After that, he spent 4 years in Rome and Kentucky before joining the Cambridge University, where he is still engaged as a university senior lecturer and convener of the graduate program in the History and Philosophy of Architecture. In Cambridge, he is also the director of studies at Gonville and Gaius College, Corpus Christi College, and Hughes Hall. Peter was an assistant professor at the University of Kentucky, a visiting professor at Rice and Harvard Universities, as well as the University of Pennsylvania. He was also a lecturer at the Central European University of Prague, and of course, the MA program at the AA, where he acted as an external examiner until 2002. From January next year, Peter will take up a post at the London Metropolitan University. Peter's close associations with Dalibor Vesely, with whom he taught, and practitioners such as Michael Graves, Daniel Libeskind, Eric Perry, or Moisen Mostafavi, who in one way or another were taught by him, are testimony to his profound impact on the practice and theory of architecture over the last 30 years. Against his eclectic academic background that includes quantum physics as well as English literature, Peter conjures up a truly interdisciplinary approach towards architecture that is firmly rooted in the reality of contemporary culture and its cities. In his prolific career as a writer, Peter has published essays on a number of topics, ranging from the godless temple to the situationist city. But it is his special interest in the work of Le Corbusier that has gained him the reputation as one of the world's leading experts on the modernist master's work. Corbusier said of ornament in his 1925 essay, Decorative Art of Today, I quote, "This taste of decorating everything around one is a false taste, an abominable little perversion. So please join me in welcoming a man of impeccable false taste, Peter Kahl."
Thank you very much, Oliver. It's a pleasure to be here. I think we've entered rather dangerous territory. I just happened to look up ornament in Roger's thesaurus. I don't know if you've been through this demonstration, but that's some of the synonyms they list. These are more. This is all under one word, and that's about the end of it. It's clear that this is a very provocative word, and going over that, it's clear that it's turned up in architecture again, in a new guise, or new guises. And it's not clear to me that what is described by the term ornament is necessarily what the phenomenon is about. And I had two choices at this point. One was a very detailed examination of one piece, which I favored, but I got hung up on the more general issue, and so I'm afraid you're getting that. And basically the idea is, and I'll develop it, and then I will get into it. It's surely provocative that one term, gosh, I'm not used to living with a mic, that one term can cover such an apparent opposite phenomena. One is cool, the other warm, the other one topological, the other topographic, perhaps. One is about the absence of the author, the other is all about the author or the inhabitant. They're both the same person in the case of the denuncio in the upper right. There is, you know, it's as if the word pattern seems to have caught everybody's imagination. It's like there's somewhere in the background, there's a way through something like pattern and something like making of capturing a much more broad architectural field. It's also perhaps one of those moments like after the 50s, when, or the scientism of the 30s through the early 50s, when, you know, architecture becomes heavy again, becomes chthonic again. And it may be part of one of those cycles. But in any case, it seems to me that it's a topic certainly worth addressing, though, as I say, I'm not sure the range of phenomena which is covered by the name are as interesting as the general topic to which it gives rise. We could take something like Rem's Jeddah Airport and say that it is both parametric and erotic, with a kind of parametric recess accepting winged Eros, and we've got sort of Woody Allen passengers getting out of it. But a lot of the discussion around ornament seems to date from Kant, when it becomes a particular kind of topic about, you know, surface and depth or essence and adornment or something like that. All of this terminology fails to do is come to terms with what the field of which the phenomenon we call ornament was originally part. And if that's the case, if that has any relevance to architectural making in the present. The field of words to which ornament appeals is mostly about adornment, sometimes well, sometimes ill, and particularly about decorum. That is to say, people who get involved with ornament have a huge range of nuances as to when you've gone too far, when you've said something, you know, beautiful and profound. The business of it being superfluous or additional or essential has mostly come out of architecture, at least as an aesthetic category, and you'll find that aesthetics is one of the ways to kill off ornament. It seems that most of what happens from Kant onwards veers between two extremes. People kind of think of ornament as, I don't know, a page of Owen Jones, and it goes in two directions, one towards geometry and the other towards beauty. On the subject of beauty, once it ceases to have any universal value, it simply doesn't matter whether somebody finds something ornament beautiful or not. You know, I can think it's beautiful and you can't, and that's all you can say, and that's fine. With respect to geometry, which seems to have claimed the field most recently, there is a kind of confusion of geometries. There's a huge area of research that's built up in the last kind of 10 years, taking traditional ornamental figures and turning them into mathematical, sort of Penrose tiles or algorithms and a variety of other kinds of representations of this kind. I'm not sure why people do this. It doesn't tell us anything about the algorithms, which we didn't already know, and it certainly doesn't tell us anything about the original ornament. But it's like the similarity of form is enough to trigger a field of associations that's possibly worth keeping on board during discussions or something. It's like the people who go into Plato and try to turn his geometry into Cartesian mathematics and prove him either right or wrong, or logic. And it just completely misses the point of what was originally going on, and you certainly don't have what was originally going on in the translation. More fundamentally, somebody like Alain Badiou tries to, he declares Heidegger's ontology romantic poetry and says he wants to go back to Plato, but Plato's geometrical figures are no longer relevant, so what we'll do is we'll build an ontology out of Cantorian set theory. I don't think it is an ontology. He's, in, to my way of thinking, he's trying to resolve a problem that has persisted since Aristotle's attempt to link his logic, the organum, with his rhetoric, but without the topics. I mean, you could say because of Venn diagrams, there's a whiff of topos in Badiou, but I just, it just doesn't, you know, there's this kind of leap through the null set that is magic. More familiar to us, but what the reason I bring him up is because at least it is an ontology. At least he has a kind of grasp of what you have to work through in order to understand what some of these phenomena, you know, is there a mathematical part of our being kind of problem? What would this as against a lot of the material that's coming out of emergence, where it's known very securely as a mathematical or computational phenomenon, somewhat less securely as a science, and beyond that, it's pretty wild metaphors. But it's like it offers a kind of hope. It's like there's a kind of paradigm there that, you know, one day will come true sort of thing. What's on the right is obviously a Baroque church, a Rococo church. We don't have time to go through it, but I just want to put enough on the table. Sorry, I hope I understand this thing. Yes. You'll see that, I mean, it's useful that it's had that this wide-angle lens has been used to take the image. At the ground, it is very dumb. It's almost pure rhythm and very laconic. This corresponds to what at the time was called the fundamentum in the music, what we would call the bass track, which for us is a bunch, you know, is a guy slapping four strings or somebody hitting, you know, electronic pads. To call it fundamentum gives you an idea, however, of what that primary rhythm is about. What happens other from then on is called aphety. That's the human, the vulnerable part, which for us has become the major part. That's become, you know, because we're it's about the human. The main thing here is that the thing is not organized around individual freedom. It's organized about how you are claimed by a larger order. Now we could go through an architectural and ornamental analysis of this. It would take us most of the rest of the evening. I think Dalibor's description in his chapter 4 is wonderful for the purpose. I will point out, however, that this business of where all the sculptural figures are and how they give access to a world that's descending. I mean, after the Counter-Reformation, vaults became a much more literal opening to heaven. And you can see that there is a heaven that's twisted off this, that's caught by a series of twists that come down. This you realize is coming back over your head, so that you see there's three windows along here. They're equal. That one is suppressed. This one is brought up and captures that new ground, even sort of casts a shadow on that figure. And you get from God through Saint Benedict down through a whole apparatus of saints through a series of horizons. While going along the ground, you're going into a deep, you know, rhythmic horizon mediated or presided over by Mary. Now, it's in that, and that's simply the building. The building itself is then set within a liturgical and seasonal temporality. And of course, that goes for all the guilds that participated in making it, the singers, and so on and so forth. In other words, this is, it's impossible to simply, you know, unless you're a plasterer, to simply take that out of the whole rest of the order. But that's, of course, what aesthetics allows you to do. And so part of the issue is trying to reconstruct enough of the order so that when one is a plasterer or one is taking a detail like that, one understands what it is. I mean, you know, you take that little bit and it becomes, you know, Deleuze allows you to invent a whole motif around fold. Or, you know, you drop it into Rhino and the first thing it asks you is what scale is it? And you say, oh shit, is this a molecule, a nose hair, a hand, a room, you know, a tree? It's a metaphor. They don't have that one on the list. But the degree to which emergence allows you to believe that through pattern, through algorithm, through a whole series of very interesting programming languages, L systems and so forth, that you might one day be able to go consistently from the level of the molecule to the level of the city, and perhaps even to, as I keep calling it, intelligence or culture. I think you have to distinguish between self-organizing and emergent. To me, a wave is self-organizing, whereas an ant colony is emergent. But I think this is, again, a sort of metaphor of continuity that isn't sustained by either the programming language or by the architectural interpretation. So it's a very obscure kind of reference because it always depends on being very upfront about the programming, and the forms tend to be form. One of the things I'm going to be coming down hard on is this notion of form, which allows you to take everything and put it all in one shopping basket. In general, the business of what is a city has developed, you know, ways of making a tragic stage set. That is to say, more beautiful, more efficient, more meaningful, higher land values, at the neglect of the comic set. These days, you find this is Half-Life 2, and you know certain rock videos. But in this one, the business of tragic and comic is rather nicely inverted in that the good guys live in the interior of blocks of a typical Central European town, and it's somewhere between Rem and Morphosis that houses all the aliens. This business of what is the order, what is that comic order, I've been on juries where things, this is New Delhi, one of the slums in New Delhi, and this is Shanghai, about a kilometer west of Pudong, where the housing practices look like a sort of bacillus. I mean, I've had people look at topographies like that and say, oh, look, it's a parametric world. I mean, I say you need the difference between bones and brick. You need all of that deep structure. You need things like language. You need things like people. I.e., it's that messy an order that you may gain a kind of intuition. I mean, through the simulation, but in terms of being able to claim that you have, you know, an architectural order that's rooted in, I don't know, bamboo structures or, you know, simulated bamboo, I think you have to build, you know, it's not simply one level of repetition or parametric order, it's a nested order of at least five levels of magnitude, which the more modest workers in the field generally admit. Right, what I want to try to do, there's a few slides from the kind of traditional understanding to try to clarify some of the terms that you see flying around in the literature. This is going to happen very quickly, so I hope it does the job. On the left are a couple of plates from the middle of the fourth millennium in Western Iran. And what they are is a sort of horned animal on a mountain. And this representation of mountain is very characteristic, i.e. is pure rhythm. But the overall structure is obviously a four-quartered circle. And what that is a representation of a temporal cycle spatially. And it's two things, one of which we're very familiar with, the notion of temporal division and its possible repetition. What's completely gone from our culture is what's represented by that. The idea that that is a temporal unity, that's just a complete and utter mystery to us. Now, I'll come back to that. But what I want to initially say is that the problem that we call ornament is the problem of, you know, that's like a fundamental statement. First of all, you can't separate the temporal and spatial rendering. It's simply a problem of finitude. That is to say, vulnerable, historical, particular humans set in some sort of more enduring context in which the primary meaning resides. That is to say, we are claimed by that primary order. It's not enough to go from ornament to cosmesis and just say universe. This actually has a structure and a fairly developed structure. It isn't inherent in the imagery. It's inherent in the deeper order. This is simply this is laboriously reconstructed from a wall that fell down by Walter Andre. It's a old Assyrian palace. And it shows you one of the characteristic things about ornament is, first of all, its association with rhythm. So it's something to do with those regular cycles. And second of all, it's generative. It is, and usually both. And so you've got these dying, reviving animals framing a plant, for example. The simultaneity of that order is the paradox. It's somehow both celestial and terrestrial. That's a Neo-Assyrian phenomenon. To give an idea of what this might mean, I'm using an image of a reconstruction of a Mycenaean Megaron. What you have in the upper left is a kind of Phoenician fusion of Egyptian and Near Eastern motifs, where, for example, you get horned altars on a column, these winged griffins, whose wings make a kind of hieratic space. There is this kind of stillness and tension that's established in this figure. This is also Mycenae. It's an unwrapped pyxis found in the Athenian Agora. Shows you the degree to which these griffins are affiliated with death and, in fact, hunting our little horned animals, our little fragile deer, presided over by this lion. But you see them behind this throne. I mean, to a certain extent, this is conjectural. To a certain extent, it's kind of a fusion of several Mycenaean sites. And this is, the Megaron is obviously a house with an opening to the heavens. But what interests me is the understanding of dwelling as being situated. And that is all the things that have to do with being host, ruler, if you're the male member of the family, your family, your relations, the things make sense in the house, everything's outside the house are, dangerous sort of world, and that is set in a horizon that is the kind of, horizon of death. The animals, as it were, lie between, lie between human history and a more primordial order. And what all those horizons of ornament are doing are articulating that mediative structure. In general, as you get closer to ritual, you get closer to rhythm. Your language becomes more poetic, your movement becomes more like dance or marching, sound becomes more like music, raw materials become more organized, become metaphoric, and that is a way in which you generate a condition by which your historical finitude is in communication with its fundamental conditions. And where's the ornament? Sorry, now I've leapt forward to the Middle Ages. Well, it starts on the walls, and then you find it on, the furniture and on ceremonial gowns. That is to say, it precisely occupies that mediating structure between human praxis and the deeper background. It's a bit like this conversation. When we're talking and thinking, it all moves very quickly. Our postures move less quickly, the furniture less quickly, and the walls and floor are most, always already there of all. We don't need to run out and see that they've changed the language or that they filled the square with lions or flooded it or something. We can keep a kind of thought going, but all that has to be in place in order to have a conversation. No, this isn't just, as it were, a flat world. I'm using a little church in west of Torino, San Michele, which sits on, as you go down this valley, you go towards Torino. It sits on this hill, pretty much looking like that. And you scramble up the hill, and you arrive at the bottom, and there's a door at the bottom of this great big box on which the apse of the church sits. You go through that door, and sorry about the color, and you hit a wall that's holding a column that supports the altar on the apse above. You turn around that wall, go up through what used to be the monk cemetery, through a door ornamented with a zodiac, and in general, the major portals are kind of ruptures in the horizon. They promise what lies beyond the horizon as a possible communication. And you then turn right, continue up the steps, turn right again, and that's the altar that's sitting over the column. And the church, I mean, it's not a terribly beautiful church. Nevertheless, it doesn't need to be beautiful. It's not all inherent in the church. It's in a much deeper order that it calls up, some of which is specifically Christian. There's an interesting reciprocity between Mary and Michael, between mercy and justice, for which we don't have time here. What I want to get at is that it's like that whole world is attached to the idea of dwelling, is attached to the idea of what it means to be historically finite and how we're claimed by the context. It's the kind of topography that lies behind Plato's divided line, which is the part that people usually don't read. They usually just read the myth of the cave, but the myth of the cave is what is illustrating this. It's not simply a dialectics of light and dark. It's this possibility of a structure from, as he puts it in The Statesman, the bottomless pit of unlikeness, i.e. pure difference, through seeming being, through dianoia, which is geometry and arithmetic, which is a propaedeutic, which gives a structure for thinking dialectically, which is your only claim on the highest good. And yes, that's what got called 2,000 years later a golden section. But the point is it's not inherent in the geometry. The geometry is being used in, you know, when I redraw it, it's all verbal in the text, is being used as a guide to thought, as a way of saying, yes, there is a continuity, and it's a continuity of differences. That's the whole point of continuity, is that the nature of the difference resonates with respect to the whole. And of course, where philosophy comes from the practical life of the polis. This stuff, whoops, I have the wrong button. I seem to have lost my, ooh, there's my little red one. There, okay. These guys are in dialogue with the priest, and you know, the temple is, I mean, it's a real Bataille notion of economy. We don't have time to go into all of that. But they are, that differentiates in a democratic city into these, you know, the gods find themselves in temples, and the rest of the culture finds itself in these agonic settings. The key one is that. This is where what you see, that's the law court, and it's basically just a horizon, and you have as many jurors as you have serious, you know, as the case is serious. At any rate, and between them resides the world of tragic drama, where the agon is understood as having a dimension of spectatorship as well as acting, i.e. the actor is never the spectator, i.e. it divides the phenomenon, unlike ritual in which you're all caught up in it. And it's out of that kind of dimension of self-reflection that you can move back and forth between the pragmatic world, practical world, and the symbolic world of God's, you know, propitiation with the conditions. Now, the reason I go into all of this is because this is where the relation between ornament, architecture, and rhetoric comes in. Because the Heidegger's phrase, for example, language is the house of being, to the extent that house is meant as something other than just another metaphor, grew out of analyzing rhetoric. and realizing that you know, the way rhetoric works is it's a language of the polis. So it doesn't represent, you know, it's not a noble's language, it's not a dock worker's language. It's the language that is common to all, and it's set up as an agon, as a confrontation. The middle section called agones, I rehearse your position, you rehearse my position when you're giving your speech. What matters is not who wins or loses, but the fact that conflict has been institutionalized as this structured agon, and we all speak the language of the polis. I mean, you got remnants of it in, you know, my learned, my noble friend and all of this, and my noble lord in the Houses of Parliament here. But it's realizing that you need that whole structure that he calls being in place in order to have that, that he starts in the inside of language and sees it as the, you know, as the most articulate dimension, as kind of penetrating the whole structure. Now, that is, in other words, all the excitement about excess and so forth grows out of two things. One, it's there in simply realizing the degree to which something like capturing a truth may necessitate, I mean, Plato's whole philosophy grew out of a disbelief, or what he called a weakness of the logoi. That is to say, the attempt to situate, how are we with the truth, or something like truth, or just the highest good. And then onto that, and that, this is what Aristotle does, is he takes dialectic out of this pure philosophic world and drops it down into something that can be brought into direct relationship with rhetoric in an effort to give rhetoric a structure so that good decisions can be made, typicalities can be understood. It's out of all of that drama that you end up with something like language's house of being, and the common problem of decorum that you see in Vitruvius and you see in rhetoric. The Roman side of that becomes much more anxious, and it has to do with being Roman, not being Greek, and being late in the Mediterranean, and a whole series of other things that would be fun to go into, but not now. All I really want to get at is that the problem that Vitruvius is struggling with, that's a kind of remnant of Plato that's kind of reheard 15 times, and a remnant of the problem of decorum coming out of rhetoric, there actually is a very deep similarity between rhetorical discourses and Vitruvius. And that problem of being situated is the thing that resides in both of them, and how to understand it. Okay, now we leap forward just quickly to cope with one example that summarizes this. This is obviously the Medici Chapel. It's about death balancing Brunelleschi's baptistry. What's interesting about this is that architecturally, this is nothing but a box with a dome on it. All of it happens in what most people call ornament. I mean, there's nothing there that's needed structurally. The whole thing is happening, or ornament or sculpture. And you come in, sorry, I'll figure this thing out by the end of the talk. You come in and see these guys first, work your way up into here, and then become aware of that, and finally, you know, the world of the dome. And the thing, the way the thing is structured manages to capture this world that constantly is constantly recurring. And what's interesting to me is the way it works with the problem of human finitude. That is to say, these figures are across each other as vitativa and vita contemplativa, but two historical figures from the Medici family who everybody knew and who died, but have been accorded a kind of a status somewhere between hero and saint, not quite divine, no longer human, and it's through their deeds that they're able to rise above this horizon, which is, you know, Michelangelo's turned into tragic masks from an egg and dart molding, to this world that resides between temporality, and originally there were supposed to be river gods, and, you know, human order, and this more paradigmatic order emerging from the singularity of light. So, but the way he handles it is one as a horizontal order, where they're looking back at Mary and she's looking at Christ as a structure of salvation, and as a vertical order from, you know, multiple temporalities, ambiguity, up through, you know, singularity, unity in light, from shadow and struggle to light. I was a kind of Neoplatonic structure that's been penetrating through the, you know, medieval and Renaissance Christianity. And it's a kind of room, I mean, I could go on, but we don't have time. It's a kind of room that establishes what this human drama is about, what the problem of finitude is about, where the architecture begins to enter it. Now, it's full of quotations from classicism. You know, it's already historicist. Is it possible to think those themes in other ways? Or is it even relevant? You know, are we not simply, you know, figments of information and energy? This would be, I'm falling behind, so this is a delightful little thing, but it isn't essential for the argument. What I want to suggest is that an insight that Le Corbusier had about our having one part of our imagination sort of caught by the temple, you know, rooted, craft, relationship with the gods, relationship with community, history adds up, sits there as a kind of memory, sits there as something, you know, people call it nostalgic, it's always marked by sadness, you know, and it looks like, I don't know, shinkle, cleanser, there sort of stuff. On the other hand, there is another world that he represented by the motor car. I've just updated this on the right by using Hagia Sophia, holy wisdom, as church, mosque, and then museum to indicate, you know, the kind of status in which this, people say this is what we should do to Jerusalem so people won't fight, that we should turn it into a museum like this. It exists in a kind of, I don't know where world. It's there. It's a tourist attraction. It's something provocative. You know, who are these strange people who made this? Do we believe this anymore? In any way, the business of the sacred, which it became in during Romanticism, as opposed to any particular religion, is embodied in this, in the status of this piece in the culture. At the bottom is simply a computer-controlled traffic system operating off CCTV cameras in LA. But the point is not the individual motor car, but the traffic. That is to say, I would suggest that if the center of rhetoric and the early notion of the traditional notion of dwelling is something like ethos, from which we get ethics, the complement to that is something like economics, which I take to be, I use this term, it's a polyvalent phenomenon. I use this term because of Adam Smith, who first really identified the motif of that simply looked epistemological in Descartes as something that had, that was existential, and gave the word economy as the gave the term economy as the name by which we are as a whole. We are no longer some sort of community. We are an economy. That is to say, some sort of description, some sort of aggregate of selfish individuals. Now, what that aggregate is, you know, any amount of statistics can define, and so on and so forth. But it's the role of individual freedom that creates this new condition of collectivity, and that has a huge effect on how we think ourselves. It obviously gives rise to the possibility of the mass as ornament. You get the phenomenon of the mass. That's obviously triumph of the will at the top and Olympiad at the bottom, and that's Lainey herself in the middle. You know, are these the only ways that we can be a collective anymore? Or otherwise, we're just a sea of individuals, you know, consuming or communicating in some way. Similarly, the long rehearsed phenomenon of the individual lost in what's called brand space, I'm not quite sure what the word space means there, but certainly brand networks of association, exemplified by the interactive mirror in the left, where you get turned into thumbnails that mix with the media message and is made physical in Jun Aoki's Louis Vuitton storefront, where the business of what it means to consume, you know, on the one hand, it looks like an object of desire, an object of identity, and yet, of course, it's part of a statistical description. You know, what is the difference between one's own belief and a demographic? Is belief simply another demographic. You end up with this tension between an integrity of sort of implicit community and an actuality of, you know, a radical distribution. And this, of course, gives rise to a whole, you know, a dream that's been alive for about 50 years, the TV screen in the street, where at the ornamental horizon, you now have individuals, these are all from Mag's website, as at Aarhus, you've got a CCTV or a webcam that is then processed and can be thrown across the whole facade, or the, you know, computer game through your cell phone in New York mixed up with the billboards, or a more conventional just video wall. What you don't realize is that that's the lower part, it's the video wall, it's the size of the galaxy. The business of sending this kind of information object as person into the landscape, you know, is this a phenomenon of ornament? Has this qualified the horizon? Is it, you know, quite what sort of a setting is being talked about? You know, it's there was a, you know, in the 60s, it was all about being, you know, 5 minutes of fame, 15 minutes of fame. Is this, it's gone down. The, you know, to be the vehicle, to be part of the billboard world, to be exemplary in some way, I mean, certainly this is the kind of, you know, people have examined this sociologically and anthropologically. They don't see it as part of the architecture. To that extent, perhaps it's ornamental. It seems to me it's not worth worrying about. It seems to me that that characterization of that aspect of public space, I mean, to me, public space is not simply public-private, but it, you know, a living room is more public than is the loo, and so on. It goes all the way up to, you know, anonymous crowd scenes, such as we're looking at probably in the lower left. But how, you know, how significant are these phenomena? It's possible to get lost in a kind of Benjamin problem, which David Lynch exploits in Twin Peaks, where you get the living room, and this is a second and a half interval between two credits that actually summarizes the whole plot. I won't go into that. Where the American living room is this, you know, reservoir of goodness, all bought on the market with these heavy, you know, and which Lynch characterizes as these heavy kind of chocolate furniture. And that is then rhymed with the roadhouse. It's happening again. And the Red Room, as Lynch's version of my San Michele stratification. But by incorporating everything in the market, and therefore messages that almost make sense, and you can't tell the difference between an alien and a god, you end up with these kind of, and he really, really does well with these kind of rebus-like moments where the muskox, you know, first of all, you get white and black, natural and, you know, mechanical, but the muskox holds the rifle the way the phone holds its receiver. The shiny black bits are doing the communicating here, the white bits are set in the black. This thing is looking at you the way, you know, the muzak, you know, that you, and it, as part of the, you know, the way the horizon, you know, just like these objects are trying to be captured, they're given a kind of monumental status, and then he refilms them so that they become like a Benjaminian problem, where he tries to work through the actual iconography of, I don't know, a matchbox in the arcade, and it doesn't make sense to him. He's simply lost. I mean, unlike, you know, he finds it immoral, he finds it strange, he develops this elaborate and very interesting discourse around it, but unlike Joyce, who simply accepts it, because for him, the city is full of mixed messages, partial messages, people who don't get it, people who are actually evil, people, you know, and it's that larger order that Lynch effectively, you know, he always alludes to, but it always becomes sort of magical and silly. But this business of a kind of transformation of objects into sort of what everybody calls signifiers means they don't have a place. And it's one of the, you know, it's one of those things you say, is that real or is that just, you know, why have we come to that? And at a more elevated level of art, you have phenomena like this, the Merzbau of Schwitters and André Breton's library, where the private world is a kind of somewhere between a collage and a religious space and, you know, just the house. And what you get in Breton's studio is, of course, actual primitive, sorry, that's the term he used, sculptures from Africa, from New Caledonia. I mean, it's, you know, no particular religion. They're just, they're kind of enigmatic. They open into a spiritual, which he mixes up them with Picabia and, you know, other paintings, surrealist paintings of friends of his. What we're touching on then is the opposite side of one of the reasons that ornament, which obviously covers so much terrain, ends up being a competition between beauty and geometry, is because that phenomenon itself penetrates this, you know, post-traditional culture. You end up constantly going back and forth between psychology, this new kind of inner life, which Picasso beautifully represents in this recycled drawer, and which is, psychology is like an invention that's only 100 years old. The term experience, similarly, it grows out of Cartesian epistemology. Once you've said that anything, all that's really valuable is that which you can know certainly, the whole rest of human understanding gets dumped into a bag called experience, and you start inventing a discipline for it that can fail, you know, that's got kind of ideologies and cures attached to it, sort of versions of redemption, that you call psychology. It has nothing to do with psyche, soul. It's this funny inner life. And the complement to that is this horizon of unknown extent, really like a mathematical infinity. It doesn't have a place. It doesn't have an end. And it's very typically represented naturally. For the Max Stern's Eye of Silence at the top, you could easily substitute any one of a number of parametric configurations that you've seen over the last 10 years. You get a sense of what this problem is about, you know, as a sort of fundamental existential condition in the one gris, where the bourgeois table, you know, extends out into, you know, through a kind of implicit window to become, you know, the grain of the table and the waves of the water, the guitar is hillside or cloud, and so on and so forth. You know, there's this, the dark there is the inside of that Picasso box, kind of looking out. I mean, this relationship is fundamental to somebody like Le Corbusier. But what it also indicates is, I'll come back to that. Remind me about house and infrastructure. About the same time, this was invented. This is Adolf Appia, about the turn of the century, one of the first people to ever use the word space the way we use it. These are speculative stage sets, originally growing out of Wagner. But what they are is matter and light together, and this bare stage that is, you know, where that on which the human drama, you know, open to the sky, takes place. It is the heart of form. It is our cardboard models, our digitally printed models with subsurface scattering. It is the matter that is the complement to whatever you can do spatially. And interestingly, it starts off in this, you know, rhythmic configuration. And it penetrates all modernist architecture from, you know, Le Corbusier to Piacentini. And it's in that world that something like this happens, where, you know, you don't have windows, you just have a kind of porosity. You've got a kind of uncertain mandala in plan, but it's at this point that the plan has become that kind of Appian ground. It's, you know, you can't tell whether it's coming together or falling apart. It's just a fragment on a Cartesian surface. It's sort of 18th century ruins as much as its modernist materials. And of course, it's full of this cutout corner. And these things are this kind of pasty chocolate and vanilla, very much like the ground, i.e. it's all happening in this horizontal form. And that, to me, it's just not worth worrying about postmodernism. It seems to me we're deep in motifs that are alive, you know, almost 100 years ago. That, you know, as much as these enigmatic buildings, nicely analyzed in Farshid and Mike's book, the kind of enigmatic surface, the turn towards translucency that began to happen I don't know, about 10 years ago, that has now materialized as, you know, it's still the light-filled wall. Because it can be given the depth, as it has here in the de Jong Museum, I don't think it's simply an enigmatic surface. It is an effort to keep the object within this domain of, you know, Fursey's right in calling attention to buildings that are blank and how much of a town is made up of them. She includes more on that list. I mean, when she starts off in warehouses, you understand what she's talking about. But by the time it gets into department stores, you're saying, should they be blank? You know, is that what our city, is our city really a kind of parametric topography of abstract objects of this kind? And the degree to which these things are figural or just more of that kind of horizontal, uncertain horizontal depth, particularly the way they emphasize pattern, is it's an open question. It's a question of how you handle it. At a next level of scale, where the thing becomes, where the proposition becomes more structural, you say to yourself, right, what really is that? It's not a tree. It's a kind of image of a tree. Certainly no tree holds up floors like that or gets more numerous at the top because, you know, it's more like a tree wrapping. So it's a kind of sign of a tree. Somewhere between the Seagram's building in Chicago and, you know, a scaleless graphic exercise, which then makes things like the furniture very, very alienated. It's a very strange place for that to be. Now, that business of interior is something we'll come back to. I mean, I it's obviously intended to be that kind of enigmatic object. And, you know, to have that the virtue of multiple readings is that it can veer between something that looks like structure, something that looks, I don't know, it's not like a tree on a boulevard. It's not like a tree that you grow. It's like it's just an image of tree. There's something quite tragic about it. Now, also in the 20s is a motif that I think you find persisting in a lot of representation or a lot of design still. This is obviously Paul Klee, Point to Line to Plane, where he spends a huge amount of effort trying to turn lyric painting into a psychophysics, where, you know, it's full of properties that are, you know, shapes or forms and colors and oppositions, and you can add them, you can, you know, you've got permutations, and they're there to serve the most lyric painting we've ever known. I think it was Danny Libeskind who first realized this could be the plan of a building. But the idea that there is some sort of, that the way to deal with nature is through knowledge, scientific knowledge, and through its modes of representation, and that gives you a claim on necessity, because what you're trying to support at the other end is this radical lyricism, you know, that's unusual, that is, you know, like a little image of the cosmos that you end up repeating over and over again as you pin more of them on the wall. This is a kind of motif that keeps coming up again and again, and I would suggest that a lot of the arguments from science to culture that are coming out of motifs like emergence are not fundamentally different from this. And of course, the first foray of the new digital procedures was in, this is now, what, almost 20 years old, were in the domain of nature, this kind of luminous nature that you could develop through force lines, and this was coming out of, you know, abstractness and the kind of thing you see in 1,000 years of nonlinear history, that there is some homology between history, geology, biology, economy, and that this was a sufficient symbol of the way they represented as an abstract machine. The other thing about this is the new way things can get made. I put this up not because that girl whom I had never met built that wall by herself, but it's as if she'd really like to have had one of those robots to build that wall. And there's a huge amount of making that takes on this kind of, in this world, that takes on this kind of robotic character, that takes on this, you know, we'll give it another twist, that we make 1,000, or what is it, 7,900, I can't count without my glasses on, bolts. And, you know, and it's like the robot is Eladio Dieste without the craft workers or without the engineering. It's become, what lies behind it is the possibility of nanomanufacture, that you might actually be able to build from the molecule up to the building, you know, the genetic brick that people dreamt about 15 years ago. In the meanwhile, it means that you as a student, especially when you don't have Swiss resources, end up being the robot. But it also means that the whole style of making, the whole way the thing has a temporality is rooted in this kind of, you know, the rhythmic surface. It's as if the surface has absorbed the horizontal motifs but become an object. And that's one of the reasons these things are so enigmatic. They seem full of possibilities, and yet when you actually start situating them in an architecture, they tend to be wall surfaces, or they tend to be in museums. They tend to be, or in the case of Gramaccio and Cola, the famous shed for grapes for the vineyard. And quite what it is, you know, what are the? I mean, I think there's lots of possibilities in this, but it's like so much of the work is at the horizon of research, is open possibilities. And to me, the business of how you rescue this kind of activity is not through reversion to craft as such, but of situating, or to say that it's ornament, i.e. to look at it as a figure, but rather to situate it into a larger understanding of what is architectural order. And that's why in the last bit, I don't want to look at these larger configurations that are almost generated purely procedurally as things, because they're all over the place as things. What I'm curious to understand is what are they as interiors? And my fear is that we're lost in the kind of Rausch that you see in André Bloch on the left. I mean, I grant you this courthouse is not one of the nicest pieces I've ever seen, but it's like that, you know, that the nowhereness of that is ostensibly part of its strength. If so, how can that be? Of course, one of the key things about modernism is they got rid of temples and rooted everything in the house. Corbett's just, you know, it just turned the whole symbolic operation upside down. And yes, we get lost in Raum Plan versus Plan Libre. That window is that window, from those of the House Müller by Loos. And I think the differences are too radically drawn. It is certainly the case that Le Corbusier is more consistent about manifesting the homogeneity of the continuity, i.e. extensity, so that the places of dwelling are more fragile than they are in the Loos. You have less of a kind of salon culture that you're supporting. There is this element of, you know, people used to talk about a new world walking into the building. You know, it's obviously nuts, but there is an element of estrangement that is part of the creativity of these topographies. That's part of the difference. But at any rate, all of that world goes away in when you start working parametrically. That is to say, you start thinking topographically, or you call it topography. It's actually topology. You have to assign it a scale. You have to assign it a material, so on and so forth. And so the nature of what its interiority is, even though it has vaults again all of a sudden, becomes something of an enigma. So I started looking for interiors of stuff that was roughly the same scale that had actually been built, that seemed to me to offer some way of understanding it. And they tend to have this kind of scale. They tend to have this remoteness. They tend to be associated with circulation and view. And whereas in Benz, there is an effort to maintain continuity so that the disruptions in them are disruptions in the surface. In somebody like Forces, they're much more fond of kind of collage structures, except possibly that courthouse at the bottom, which seems to be a bad Zaha. Whereas Zaha actually has quite an interesting imagination about how this world might come together and seems to think about it quite hard. In the early ice storm exhibition, I mean, this is an image before it got mounted, these sorts of things seem possible to be places. You don't quite know whether they're for dwelling or for the imagination, but they're sufficiently close. And the way that that begins, you know, it isn't quite a fractal division, but the way that accepts, you know, that eventually became furniture and tables and things like that. The way it could differentiate and become settings seemed to me quite a provocative intuition. Similarly, the way the BMW is structured from this concrete world where the workers are to this kind of machine horizon where these pupae or little models of the building go through at a regular rhythm. And finally, the, you know, the strided light of the ceiling seems to me a way of working with what starts out as, or what at first glance looks like a purely formal order, and actually begins to build it into something that resonates beyond its purely formal. You know, it isn't just an assembly. There is an architecture. There is a place. Yes, it's full of all the flow arguments, and is very consistently related to, you know, who are these workers? They're certainly not craftsmen, but it seems to me that it's actually constituted. It's understood what these new conditions are. Now, if we quickly drop back to the 50s for a minute, and this is probably one of the buildings that allowed people to say, we can reinvent architecture from scratch. There are two key figures represented. You'll be grateful to hear I'm not going to go through this. One is obviously the Virgin Mary in the morning, the sun comes through and makes the cross and square at the center line of the church by the high altar, as an embodiment of the incarnation. And the other in the afternoon, when the sun comes around to the west, produces this bull figure on the facade, which he publishes. And this is a painting he did in 53 on Pentecost, where another divine child, but a child beast, is born, the Minotaur, who, of course, is sacrificed to make Athens, or to refound Athens. And what's interesting is that to set it up as that thematic aggression between the Virgin and, or between Christ and the Minotaur, puts in play a much larger order. I mean, you don't even need to know about that iconography. You know, is that ornamental or is that part of the primary order? There's a whole world of cells of light that build up to the shadow realm in which these figures begin to stand forth as different kinds of light, finally as seats, you know, twice bolted to the ground on their own little stylobate. Or similarly on the outside, where you get these moments where the sky seems to continue into the solid wall and the voids are with the solids, part of, you know, places that one of the figures he was looking at while working on this was Bataille, and the motif of sacrifice as a bloody sacrifice was part of the reason that the altars look like they do, and also that this is, he's interested in undermining the purely salvational story of Christ with the chthonic beast of the Minotaur. Now, I don't know that it has to take this form. I think it's interesting that this building seems to be both arbitrary sculpture and something that has a real dignity. I think that's something about interior. I think that's something about our, you know, it recovers in a new way. As I say, you don't really need the iconography. I think it helps you get into the level of violence that's involved and the sort of movement between structure and violence. But just to finish, I want to look at one parametric building, and I'm not sure George thinks as highly of it as I do. It's his building. that I think manages to capture what is going on with these parametric orders in respect of what an architectural order is. It was the Cerusi Pavilion, which was on a hill of André Bloch's estate. She bought it. And it's up in here where there's presently a shed. These are his habitacle. I'm sure you know this, so I can go through it. He produced it as three boards and a model, and basically, mathematically, it comes out of two orders. One having to do, you see the way they have an even number of intervals around the circle that then generate these lines that follow the cycloid. It's actually built out of half circles. And so you can get a wall by having, you know, a diameter zero. And then the other order, which, you know, it's not, doesn't matter which comes first, is a kind of extension in depth which can be modulated through the mathematical function that governs that curve. And then he indulges in a way of combining them so that the orders of the parametric order and the architectural order are kind of made seamless. Now, there's something almost arbitrary about that, and it results in, you know, junctions that need to be resolved. But it eventually results in something like a house, where, you know, you've got a kind of inner courtyard and rooms around. I mean, they aren't quite rooms. But what's interesting to me is that the parametric order, the most systematic part, the thing has not been designed in plan. It's like it's been designed in elevation. And what you have is this world of rhythmic horizons that is stated in its most laconic, most mathematical level, but through the process of intersection begins to generate openings that become more thematic. It becomes attached to the ground. This this thing is, you know, that's the only place light is admitted to a world that's got roofed over. There's a table in there. He calls it a flower. It's obviously also erotic in several other ways. It's also the structural center of that thing. These lines are turned into structural devices that are brought in on a lorry. But the thing that intrigues me is that he's not afraid or not. He's found a subject. He's got a there which gives the parametric order something other than just an obey the rules quality, a systematic quality. It's become part of a topic. It's become part of a thematic of dwelling that is nonetheless consistent with its primary order, which includes an interesting model base built out of a text that comes from Ben Al-Kashe, that is similar to, you know, the ground on which Mallarmé's coup d'etat becomes a gulf. You know, are the words, you know, this business of physis and logos, word addressed to sight. I mean, you're basically dealing with a very ancient motif of, you know, da and sein, if you like. Right. The real question is whether any, you know, whether anything has been discovered in this attempt to bring together or to rethink the nature of what's called ornament in a traditional culture and use that as a vehicle for understanding a contemporary culture, which I think is too often sold down the river as simply economic in all sorts of ways. I think the conditions of, I mean, it's like ethos. You're not given it. It's something you create through conflict, through involvement. It doesn't have to do with being Greek or being Italian or being Islamic or whatever else. It's something that comes out of the finitude of being human, of needing other humans. I think there is something like profundity that attaches to being human, that it is not simply emergent. It's not simply information. I think if you acknowledge motifs like that, you may say that a concept or a symbol like the unity of time is nostalgic, but there's something similar on the table, and it's something, you know, that, you know, I don't think we can do it with symbols. I certainly don't think it's worth recovering old symbols. But I think we are still the fundamental conditions of what it means to be human, the business of being claimed by a world, the business of being human, and where, you know, what that means as something other than simply productivity, I mean, people like Agamben are very forceful about how we turned our culture upside down from using our resources to make a rich politics to using our sophisticated politics just to manage our resources. And, you know, is that really what sustainability is about? Or is it, in fact, an opportunity to acknowledge from the, you know, in the practical domain, is it as a kind of what I'm calling an architectural imagination? I mean, Danny did this 30 years ago as a critique. He calls it the borough laws, because he thought all of architectural representation in the 60s and 70s was caught in a trap, which, you know, looked like these kind of drawings, these sort of axonometric representational drawings. I don't know if this is ornamental or not now. And, you know, through, you know, to deny it is one side of the story. What the nature of reaffirmation is, I mean, are you simply denying a set of procedures? Are you denying a set of prejudices that are, let's say, built into museum or the relation between museum and shopping? There is a point at which you can no longer deny that which it means to be human. And it seems to me there's actually, if we drop the term ornament, but think of it as, you know, an aspect of what constitutes an architectural imagination, there's actually a huge amount of creative, you know, and relevant work to be done. And it becomes a way of fitting our smaller areas of research into something that is more than disposable. Sorry to take so long. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Abuse?
Where can we see you lecture next?
It's a good question. Sometime in the new year, I'm moving to LMU, so I'm happy to get together and chat, you know, over coffee or whatever else. Whose studio are you in?
You know, Jonas.
Oh yeah, right. We'll have long conversations. Great.
Any other questions more towards ornament? I think everybody's pretty much speechless.
Thanks. Let's say that I understood that the way you described ornament as what is the historical role of ornament, let's say. I understood that. But let's say, are you saying that there is a different way of understanding the ornament in this parametric versus...
Yes, I think ornament is a
the
term
other way.
That's gotten plucked out of... there's a reason it's come out of rhetoric, which I went into, but I think it's gotten plucked out of that as a way of trying to control a phenomenon that has become aesthetic. It's become an aesthetic object, so you could try to control it with concepts. And what I'm interested in doing is setting in place the larger order of which these ornamental discussions are a part. Otherwise, you end up, you know, chasing a Caribbean hut and hanging onto it for dear life and trying to extrapolate that to the rest of culture. I mean, it's, you know, hugely impressive. It's also something slightly embarrassing. You know, it's like something, it's not that easy, being human or being an architect. And I don't think clients should think architecture is that easy either. And I think the issue, you know, what's happened, I mean, the Arab Stratford city was enough of a problem, but what replaced it is, you know, a mall. How is it possible to say, you know, that should be a town? We can do a more profitable town. Oh, that's what I wanted, was a profitable town. You know, I want to live in the shop window. You know, and so one of the things I'm trying to do with this is to set it's only an hour, so you can't, is to set a, rethink what it means to have an architectural imagination. I mean, it's not like I think that, you know, I think certain bits of work are good or bad, but as I say, that just doesn't matter. What I'm more interested in is I see an awful lot of work going into research, it seems to keep repeating itself. And it doesn't seem to know how to grow out of that, how to change, how to criticize, you know, how to have a sense of humor, or vice versa, if it's all humor, how to be serious. And, you know, what does it mean to be serious? You know, is a sense of humor look like Venturi? It's kind of one-liners. I mean, to me, it's more like wit. You know, it's something, you know, children are young and easily frightened, as poor Schumann has heard me say probably 100 times. You know, it's got that, it starts off all about children and, you know, how they grow up, but it's not a joke. You know, and I think, you know, there's plenty of scope for that in architecture. And I think, you know, people can get too hung. I mean, the whole phenomenon of thinking architecture in terms of rules grew out of aesthetics. And that's one of the things that's gotten confused with, you know, logical procedures in computation. I mean, you look at the early discussions of Eisenman on what he was doing, it was like he said, oh my gosh, this is something that makes up rules. What a fantastic machine. You know, whether or not he was doing animations in Maya or whatever it was. And so what I'm trying to do is, it's not a historical view. I mean, to a certain extent it is historical, because I think there is a kind of period that shows a huge continuity of motifs, of themes, of ways of just understanding being human. And I think there are, you know, there's a lot of that that's left. I mean, we still, you know, poo, we still sleep, we talk face to face, we sit, we lie, we fight, you know, so on and so forth. There's a huge amount of what we do that's still pretty much the same. At the same time, there's no question that, you know, if globalization is an extensive phenomenon, it's also challenged a lot of possibilities of intensive thinking. You know, what is ethos? Is it, if it's not race, if it's not gender, if it's not my community, should we have a nation? Or should we just, you know, express our loyalty to cities? Isn't that enough? I mean, I happen to think so. I mean, London wouldn't go attack Baghdad. We'd have its own problems, but at any rate, I mean, you know, I think cities are big enough. I mean, the population of the whole Roman Empire is the population of Britain now. I think cities are big enough. At any rate, we can wander off. As I said, but the main thing is, there's a whole series of terms that you see in the literature when you start reading about it. And I think it's really interesting the way it comes up, that you know, they kind of don't register, and you're saying, well, what is this phenomenon? They're obviously all, everybody can read this. It's not quite clear what everybody's thinking when they do read it. But is there something, you know, that in the way that I tried to suggest, if only briefly, that there was some continuity between that Church of San Michele and the way Plato got from, you know, Orphic myth to a thematization of geometry as a problem of ontology. It's that kind of phenomenon and being able to go back and forth between them.
So one thing that I'm understanding, let's say, is that there is, yeah, that you need to understand the order behind everything, and that maybe some research that is going on right now, it doesn't chase that order and doesn't question it.
Yeah, I think there's a tendency to think order looks like mathematics or geometry.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons you end up people perfectly happy, you know, living in systems, you know, it's this kind of weird tension between systems and psychology. I mean, I have absolutely no time for psychology. I mean, I think talking to other people can help. I think, you know, there's a, but as a way in which culture is culture, you know, the idea that I have a dream that is Oedipal, and that somehow connects me to ancient Greece, I mean, stuff it. I think the emphasis is too much on psychology. And what is collective psychology? Crowds? You know, more people buy Britney Spears than buy Kanye West? By the way, Kanye West's website is really interesting. I just don't understand why he doesn't have any books. He's got everything else. You know, fairly amusing houses, fashion, art, but no books. I don't know what that's about.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions?
I think it's time for dinner.
On that note, I think we're going to close.
Thank you.
Thank you.